Yeah, I have a couple of things here I want to just kind of help us with this morning. How many of you, you know what, I think probably everybody here knows what this right here is, right? A sword, right? Yeah, no, not very hard, is it? It's actually a part of a larger piece called a Maasai spear. This part they use as a sword, and the Maasai warriors in Africa, and it is a sword, and it's pretty amazing. It's a pretty amazing thing, and so how many of you know what this is? And don't say a spatula, okay, or an egg flipper or anything like that. It's not. It's a trowel, right? What do you do in the trowel? You build with a trowel, right? You take the trowel and the mortar and mortar brick, right on up, right? And then this, you know what you do with this, right? You fight. So, and this is kind of a picture of Nehemiah chapter 4 today, that we are not simply called to build, but we are also called to fight as well. I'm going to lay that right there and hope I don't hurt myself. All right, and several years ago in the 1800s, a man by the name of Charles Haddon Spurgeon. How many of you have heard of Spurgeon? One of the great preachers, maybe of any era in Christendom. And in the 1800s, Spurgeon preached in a church called the Metropolitan Baptist Church in London, England. He began there at 18 years of age. And on a given Sunday, later on in his life, on a given Sunday, he was preaching to about 5,000 people. Now, that was unheard of in those days. They didn't have sound systems, so you can imagine the way they had to construct buildings and that sort of thing to make all of that happen. But Spurgeon is, if you can still go and read Spurgeon's sermons online, they are in print form online. And in fact, Spurgeon's sermons became such on demand that they printed out every week. They came to print out a newspaper every week with his sermon and with other things from him. It was sort of like a 1800s blog that he would put out, right? And that was passed around. And Spurgeon named this newspaper out of Nehemiah chapter 4. The name of the newspaper was The Sword and the Trowel. Sword and the Trowel. Because both of those are a part of Nehemiah chapter 4. And we see that here. Not only is there a need to build, but there is a need to defend what you build. So that you build as dad, as a father, you build your home, you build your family, but you have to defend your family too. You have to be willing to fight for your family. And we've seen through this study that the Christian life is often a fight. It is not just building, but it is also a fight as well. Now, in Nehemiah, we've seen the heart of a rebuilder, a man who was called by God. He said that I may rebuild it. That was his purpose in life. At this point in his life, God had called him back to the homeland of his fathers to rebuild the wall of Jerusalem that had been torn down when Jerusalem was sacked by the Babylonians. Many years have passed. The wall is not built. Nehemiah hears from God, go and rebuild the wall. He goes to build the wall and sets himself to do this. And the people come together in an amazing way. As we saw last week, in 52 days, they rebuilt this entire wall around the city of Jerusalem, still considered by engineers today an engineering marvel, just an amazing thing by engineers even today. They didn't have backhoes. They didn't have any of those kinds of things. They didn't have a Bobcat Royce. You know, they built it by hand. Sword. There was a trowel, but there also, as we're going to see, there had to be the sword. Now, I'm going to have Brandon McBath come. He's going to read our scripture in Nehemiah chapter 14. Come on up, Brandon, and you follow along with him from Nehemiah chapter 14.
All right. We're in Nehemiah 4:15-23. The subtitle of this section says, "The Work Resumes." When our enemies heard that it was known to us and that God had frustrated their plan, we all returned to the wall, each to his work. From that day on, half of my servants worked on construction and half held the spears, shields, bows, and coats of mail. And the leaders stood behind the whole house of Judah, who were building on the wall. Those who carried burdens were loaded in such a way that each labored on the work with one hand and held his weapon with the other. And each of the builders had his sword strapped at his side while he built. The man who surrounded the trumpet was beside me, or sounded the trumpet, sorry, was beside me. And I said to the nobles and to the officials and to the rest of the people, the work is great and widely spread. When we separated on the wall, far from one another, in the place where you hear the sound of the trumpet, rally to us there, our God will fight for us. So we labored at the work, and half of them held the spears from the break of the dawn until the stars came out. I also said to the people at that time, let every man and his servant pass the night within Jerusalem, that they may be a guard for us by night and may labor by day. So neither I nor my brothers, nor my servants, nor the men of the guard who followed me, none of us took off our clothes, each kept his weapon at his right hand.
Now, I think you see here that there is a need in this passage of Scripture. There's both a need for a sword and a trowel, right? There's a fight going on. There are enemies that are standing against God's people, and we've seen that all the way through this passage of Scripture. And in this passage, what we see is three different times Nehemiah tells us what he said to the people. Remember, this is Nehemiah's journal as he's speaking to the people. And he said three things. He makes three statements to them. And around those three statements, we're going to see a picture of what God says to us as his people as well. And how God speaks to us. Because what we see happening physically here in the building of the wall and this whole struggle to build the wall, what we see physically there is really a picture of what is happening spiritually in our own lives as well. And so we're going to see what is God saying to us through Nehemiah's statements about how we are specifically to fulfill our responsibility to each other in his work. Nehemiah said we all return to the wall, each to his work, and we want to recognize our responsibility in God's work. Now, so Nehemiah says, and I looked and I rose and I said to the nobles, the first statement of Nehemiah, I said to the nobles and to the officials and to the rest of the people, do not be afraid of them. Remember the Lord who is great and awesome. Now, if you stop right there, you could say, well, this is kind of a passive thing. This might be the kind of thing that a trial would just a trial would be sufficient for this. And because you just go back and remember the Lord. And some people kind of want to live the Christian life. Okay, we just remember the Lord. He'll take care of us. And they sort of live out a passive kind of Christianity. But that's not where it ends, right? Remember the Lord and do what? It's all right to talk. Remember the Lord and... And fight for your brothers. Fight for them. And for your sons. Fight your brothers and for your brothers and your sons and your daughters and your wives and your homes. And when the enemies heard of us, they heard what was going on, frustrated their plan. And here's what it says, verse 16. From that day on, half my servants worked on construction and half held the spears, the shields, the bows, the coats of mail. If this had been a church, their new members packet would have included a sword, a shield, a black jacket, a mouthpiece, and a helmet. And this is serious stuff, folks. And what we need to understand, listen, what we need to understand is the Christian life is not just a walk in the park. The Christian life is not just flowers and everything is sweet and light and all of that. The Christian life is a battle. And some of us are getting soundly beaten because we don't understand it's a battle. And some churches are getting soundly beaten because they think if it's just all sweetness and light, then we're not engaging ourselves in the war and in the battle. And what I want us to see here in this statement is simply this, that God is calling us as his people to go to war beside each other. Go to war beside each other. Not with each other, but beside each other. right? And this, again, is a physical picture of what's happening spiritually around us. It's not, and I want you to see this too, that it's not just an individualized fight that God has called us to. He has not just called us, not just you fighting your battle and me fighting my battle. It is a corporate battle that we fight together. God never intended for us to be separated in this process, but that we battle together. We battle together. It is a corporate fight. It is us together fighting the enemy. And there's trial work going on, but there's also sword work going on as well. Now here at Beach Grove, there's a lot of trial work going on. I mean, yesterday, if you were here yesterday, if you came by yesterday, you saw a bunch of cars, there's trial work going on. There's some basketball, and kids are coming in, and we're working with the kids, and we're seeking to build the kids, and we do car care, as Libby mentioned a minute ago, some of these different ministries that we do, trial work going on. We have lots of trial work going on. We got to be careful that we don't forget that there's also sword work to be done. That this is a battle and that we do have an enemy. And he is not just your enemy and my enemy, he is our enemy. He does not just want to derail your life, but he wants to derail the life of the church and make the church a laughingstock and tear down the glory of Christ, getting to Christ through us. He cannot touch him and cannot defeat him, but he does seek to come at him through people like you and people like me and churches like us. And so we come to understand that there is a battle to be fought, and it is a corporate battle. God's word says to us, 1 Peter chapter 5, that we are to cast all our anxieties on him because he cares for us. But it doesn't stop there. It says, be sober-minded and be watchful. It's not just a passive thing, but we are to be sober-minded and to be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion seeking someone to devour. That sounds like serious business to me. If I were to tell you today that somewhere in this community there was a one of these sanctuaries that has the big cats, and we were to get word that a lion had escaped from that sanctuary, would you walk to the car the same way you would had you not gotten that word? I want you to understand there's a lion loose. And until the Lord says his time is over, he is loose. And he is a danger. And so he prowls around seeking whom he may devour, and we've got to be at battle. We've got to take our battle stations together. The scriptures tell us that for though we walk in the flesh, we are not waging war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but have divine power to destroy strongholds. Now listen to what it says. So we destroy arguments and every lofty opinion raised against the knowledge of God. And I want to stop right there, and I want you to understand that this battle is primarily fought in the realm of ideas. It is primarily fought in the realm of the way you see life and perceive life and interpret life. Your worldview matters. And that you have a worldview that is according to God's worldview matters. And therefore we have the Word of God. We have the Word of God. And so we take every thought captive to do what? To obey Christ. We don't just give it our best shot and come up with our best idea. We realize that there is someone who has instructed us in what is right and what is wrong, in what is the right way to think about things and the wrong way to think about things. And by the way, there is still a right and wrong. Amen. And in this, we come to understand that it is our ideas matter. Our thought life matters. And so we take every thought captive to what? To the obedience of Christ. He has spoken to us and instructed us, and we follow in His way. You understand that? And so this battle is primarily being fought in the realm of ideas. That's why it matters what you're teaching your children. That's why it matters what we're teaching our children. That's why it matters what we're teaching in our Sunday school classes, in our small groups. That's why it matters what we are, how we are interpreting life and interpreting what's going on around us. It's not just you doing your best and me doing my best with my best ideas and your best ideas. It is us coming together, fighting together under the banner of the Word of God. And so the Scriptures tell us that we have the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. And we pray at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication. And to that end, we keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints, giving us a picture of what our weapons are, right? What are our weapons? They're the Word of God and prayer. And so we both come at the end of this battle armed with the sword of the Spirit, it's called, the Word of God. And we come into this in prayer. And not just prayer for me and mine, but prayer for us, right? Me praying for David, and David praying for me. Me praying for Patty, and Patty praying for me. We pray for one another, and we support one another under the Word of God and in prayer. Now, so the first thing God says to us through Nehemiah is that we fight for our brothers and our sons and our daughters and our wives and our homes. We understand that we fight, we go to war beside each other. Now, the second thing he said is this: and each of the builders had his sword strapped at his side while he built. The man who sounded the trumpet was beside me. Now, here's the second thing Nehemiah says. And I said to the nobles and to the officials and to the rest of the people, the work is great and widely spread, and we are separated on the wall far from one another. In the place where you hear the sound of the trumpet, rally to us there. Our God will fight for us. So again, it's not passive, right? He doesn't just say, our God will fight for us. We just sit back and no, we rally to one another. And in rallying to one another, we are strong together. Jesus said, wherever two or three are gathered together in my name, there I will be among them. Does that mean the Lord is not with you if you're by yourself? No, of course not. What is it saying to us? It's saying that we are stronger together. And His work is mighty as we come together. And there is a strength that we know together that we do not know when we are apart. So we come together with each other. We rally to each other. You know, the church is the only entity where people think we can fight a war and be absent. Do you understand what I'm saying? That we can fight a war and not come together. I hear it almost every week, somebody saying, well, I can have church out here wherever I am, just with whatever I'm doing. Is that a biblical picture of the church? If we're going to think of the church biblically, is that a biblical picture of the church? The biblical picture of the church is that we come together. And there are two different ways of coming together. I want you to understand this. There are two different ways of coming together. We can come together like this, barely touching each other. And a lot of people, that's how they want church to be, because, listen, the come together that I think the New Testament gives us is a little bit uncomfortable for us. It's a little bit, especially us in our Western world where we like our space. You know, you're standing too close to me. But here's how so many people think of church. Like this. But here's the biblical picture, church. That we come together like this. That your life is intertwined with mine and mine with yours. That we come and are intermingled with one another. That there is more than just this. That it's this. And that even to the point of sometimes being a little bit uncomfortable. Because in coming together like this, we are strong. God created you as a relational person. Did you know that? And He created you. Listen, God Himself is relational, a relational God. What was the first thing the Lord said? One of the first things the Lord said to Adam, He said, it is not good for you to be alone, Adam. He wasn't just talking about a woman. There's a larger principle there. And that principle is that God created us to be relational beings. In fact, God himself is a relational being. I mean, look at the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit existing always, none of them created, all of them existing for all of time. Will that blow your mind? All time together, three in one. If you want to understand a picture of this, read John chapter 17. Jesus praying to the Father and praying about us, praying about you and me, and saying, Father, I want them to be one as we, God the Son and God the Father, are one. That's what he desires for you and for me. That we come together in oneness, not like this, but like this. That our lives interconnect and that we are strong together. I'm telling you, this right here, this kind of picture of the church is the kind of picture where we say, well, I'll just go to church on Sunday and I'll sit down in the chair and sort of like a butterfly, when everything's sort of said and done, I'll fly away. Right? But that's not God's picture of the church. What do we say here? We say we don't just go to church, we are the church. Don't just go to church, be the church. That's more than just coming and lighting like a butterfly for an hour or so, depending on how long the preacher preaches, and then flying away, right? It is this. Listen to this picture. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Now there are a variety of gifts, the same Spirit. There are varieties of service, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who empowers them all in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for what? The common good. For the body, but fast forward down to verse 14. For the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot should say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. But as it is, God arranged the members in the body, each one of them as he chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? Where would this amazing, miraculous thing of God's people working together with different gifts and different abilities, like the hand and the foot have different roles in the same body, where would that be? The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you. Nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. Do you see? This is a biblical picture of Christianity. This is a biblical picture of the church. I hope you get this. That means that our connection in the local church, the local body, matters. That connecting young people and old people and everybody in between, that matters. That our doing this and not this matters. That we rally to each other. Because there's a battle going on. And we need each other. And we help each other, and God works in this beautiful picture that is called his church as we come together like this right here. Do you see that? I hope you get a picture of the New Testament church. That's God's desire. So it's not like a guy said to me one time, he picked up and he goes to another local church and he says, well, I'm just changing venues. This is not a venue. This is the body of Christ, the local body of Christ, interconnected and intertwined and intermingled with one another. So the church is about coming together and rallying to each other. Now, so the last statement we see in verse 20, in verse 23, I think here, 22, he says in verse 21, so we labored at the work, and half of them held the spears from the break of dawn until the stars came out. I also said, third statement, I also said to the people at that time, let every man and his servant pass the night within Jerusalem, that they may be a guard for us by night and may labor by day. So neither I, nor my brothers, nor my servants, nor the men of the guard who followed me, none of us took off our clothes. Each kept his weapon at his right hand. So what's number three here? Watch out for each other. We watch out for each other. We help each other see the landmines along the way. We are open enough and we build relationship enough so that Rachel can come to me and say, Pastor Kenny, I'm concerned about this and I want to share this with you. I see a landmine that you might be just about to step on. And I say, well, thank you, Miss Rachel. Where is that? Tell me so I don't step on the landmine. I mean, doesn't that make sense? You know where they are. Some of you have been at this for a while. And there are some of you who are kind of new at this whole thing that we call Christianity, this whole venture of the faith. So what do? We help each other, and we are open enough so that we can say, hey, wait a minute, I see that you might be just about ready to step on a landmine here. I was blessed in my life to have people around me who at times kind of waved that red flag and said, wait a minute, Ken, about to step on a landmine. Last Sunday, after we left worship here together, we went home, and sitting there with our two granddaughters, after we ate a meal together, I've got the 6-year-old Ellie here and the 4-year-old Elizabeth here, and I'm just in sort of poppy heaven sitting there, you know, and they're watching this cartoon. And we call it cartoon, an animated series called Masha and the Bear. It's just a really cute, kind of crazy show. But there was something that happened in there, and I want you to watch it. We're going to watch just a 10-second piece of it, and I want you to see it. You can tell what's going to happen before it happens. Okay, watch and see if you can tell what's going to happen before it happens. There you go. Did you see it coming? Anybody here ever done that? Yeah. So little Elizabeth, 4-year-old Elizabeth, looks up at me and she says, Poppy, has that ever happened to you? And I know this is kind of maybe silly to you, I don't know. But I had this moment where I remembered back place and time in my childhood. I can remember right where I was standing. I can take you there right now. My grandfather was standing there with me. And we were working, and I had a rake in my hand. And I took the rake, and I set it like that. And my grandfather, who would call me son, no, son, like this. And he pushed it down into the ground. And he said, this way, nobody trips over it, nobody steps on it, nobody gets hurt. Now, I know that's a little thing. But what I'm trying to tell you is that God blessed me in my life to have people that warned me, that showed me. If you said it like this, somebody's going to get hurt. If you keep living out that way in your family, somebody's going to get hurt. If you keep that pattern in your life, you know what it is today. I mean, the Holy Spirit, I trust the Holy Spirit. If you keep that pattern in your life, somebody's going to get hurt. Do you see what God has given us? What a gift He's given us in the church. That there are people around us who've been there before. Some of them stepped on the landmines. They can tell you about the wounds. Some of them were warned by somebody else and can tell you, no, you don't say it like this. I remember a man in the church where I grew up, over at Valley Grove Church, by the name of Ernest Underwood. Ernest Underwood was just a tease. I mean, he was one of those guys that just loved to tease kids and just play with them. And sometimes he'd get a little frustrating, and I'd get a little frustrated at him, and he'd say, now, you better learn to love me. You're going to have to spend eternity with me. And I remember as a teenager, on a Sunday night, going in and sitting down with a group of boys, and we weren't acting like we were supposed to be acting. And there was one boy in particular who needed the Lord, needed help, but he was influencing all the rest of us. And Ernest Underwood said, Ken, bad company corrupts good character. 1 Corinthians 15. That boy needs you to influence him. don't you let him influence you. And a landmine was avoided. Do you see the picture here that we watch out for each other? And you can't do that if you're going to live your life like this. Because nobody has permission to come in to even begin to help you. And you're destined to step on landmine after landmine after landmine. Because you're not willing to listen to anybody. And you're not availing yourself to this. God causes His people to fight beside each other, to rally to each other, and to come together in a way that, that is like this, not like this. And in that process, God's way, God's the picture of the church becomes clear to the church around, to the world around us. And so much so that Jesus would say, by this shall all men know that you are my disciples, that you love one another. And it's not just about us loving each other, but it's about an evangelistic picture and an evangelistic working of God, of us being the church and the world around us saying, wow, those people love each other. They care about each other. They rally to each other. They fight for each other. They come together. They help one another. Watch out for one another. Listen to the Word of God. Brothers, if anyone is caught in any transgression, you who are spiritual should restore him in a spirit of gentleness. You can't do that like this. Keep watch on yourselves, lest you too be tempted. Don't be haughty and think somehow you got all the answers, is what it's saying. You got to be careful when you do that. And make sure you yourself are not going to stumble in this process. And so, you bear one another's burdens and fulfill the law of Christ. The law of Christ is what? The law of love, right? The law of grace. Listen to the Word of God. My brothers, if anyone among you wanders from the truth and someone brings him back, let him know that whoever brings back a sinner from his wandering will save his soul from death and cover a multitude of sins. You can't do that like this. It's not going to work that way. You're going to have to be willing to come together like this. Listen, can we please get past a style of music and a style of worship and a presentation, however you want to say it. Can we get past that enough to do this? I mean, if there might have been a song this morning I didn't like. This might have been. Somebody else here loves that. And it's not about me. Do you understand that? It's not just about me. And so I'm not here just for me. I hear people say, well, it's about this. Yes, but this creates this. And if it doesn't, then this is not real. And so we come together and we put aside differences and we put aside generational things and style things and preferences. We come to a place where we experience this, and I'm telling you, this is beautiful. This is beautiful. And this is what God desires for you and for me. In that little book, often ignored book of Ecclesiastes in the Old Testament, listen to these words. Again, I saw vanity or emptiness or futility under the sun. One person who has no other, either son or brother, yet there is no end to all his toil. This guy's working himself to death. His eyes are never satisfied with riches. He thinks life is about material things. So that he never asks, for whom am I toiling and depriving myself of pleasure? This is futility. This is vanity and an unhappy business. This is living like this. But listen to what it says. Two are better than one because they have a good reward for their toil. What a beautiful picture. Two are better than one. We say around here, many hands make light work. For if they fall, one will lift up his fellow. But woe to him who is alone when he falls and has not another to lift him up. Again, if two lie together, they keep warm. This would have been this kind of uncomfortable for us, maybe. But in that part of the world, you're out traveling, and you didn't have a place to lay down that night, and it's really, really cold. You're going to get up close to each other to keep each other warm so you survive the night. So they keep warm, but how can one keep warm alone? And though a man might prevail against one who is alone, two will withstand him. And then there's an amazing statement here, kind of a mysterious statement. A three-fold cord is not quickly broken. What's that talking about? I understand, too, you've got one man and another man, one woman, another woman. You've got two people together. What is that two people? Where's the three? Who's the three? The Lord. The Lord. The picture here is this. Of you take two pieces of cord and a rope and you tie them together, two pieces of yarn, you braid them together. There is a certain tensile strength there, but there is a tremendous weakness there. But what happens when you put the third there? And what happens when the third is divine? Do you understand? And what happens is this miraculous, amazing thing called the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ. Christ who loved the church and gave himself for her, for us, for you and for me, dying on the cross that we might come together, that we might be strong together in this community. Not just like this, this. And we might be caring for each other so much that a little child walks up to Miss Rachel, or a little child walks up to Mr. Bill, a little child walks up to Miss Marita and says, "Hi, my name is," and that child and that person begin to interconnect with each other. And one day, right now, that older person connecting with that younger person and speaking into their life. But one day, there may come a time when that older person will need somebody to come alongside them and help them. And if God is doing his work among us, you know who that'll be? One of the people that'll be there will be that little child. Somewhere along the way in their life, that little child. And there is this working together of God's people. It's not this, but it's this. Will you pray with me that God will help us to be this? Not this, but this. I wonder if there's somebody in this room today who needs to open up their heart to the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm telling you, you can't know the fullness of the relationship that God wants you to know until you are saved, gloriously saved by the blood of Jesus Christ, who came and died on the cross to save you from your sin. The praise team's going to come right now, and they're going to lead us in a song that we sang last week. More love, more power, more of you in our lives. And can we make that our prayer this morning? If you have not submitted your life to Jesus Christ this morning, would you simply, in your own thought processes there, just bow your head and say, "Lord Jesus, I repent of my sins. I trust that you died on the cross for me. I hear you calling me unto yourself. And Lord Jesus, this morning I come to you. I believe that you died for me on the cross. I believe that you rose again from the grave. And I entrust my life to you." But I'm going to tell you, it's not just an individual decision. Would you just be willing to turn to somebody close by? Or maybe even step out and walk down the aisle and say, "Pastor Kenny, today I've given my life to Jesus Christ. I've submitted my life to him." We will celebrate with you in this time together. Let's pray.